that's gonna be hymn number 109. So if you wanna look that one up, you might be able to follow along with the words a little bit better. You know, they're kind of antiquated Elizabethan English, so that might help you a little bit. And the second psalm was inspired by Psalm 62. So if anybody wants to turn to that, kind of follow, it doesn't follow it word for word or anything like that, but it might help you follow that psalm as well.
And trust his steadfast. out your heart. And God, our refuge, and trusted in Him to hear you cry. No other hope will never fail you. No other love will not run dry. I'll not be shaken. I'll not be shaken. For all my hope is in His love. From God alone comes my salvation. His steadfast love.
The text for this morning's sermon comes from Exodus chapter 20. Verses 1 through 6. And God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments.
All right, as you find your place there, if you haven't already, in Exodus chapter 20, do want to again thank Wes for playing and being with us today. Many of you know that's Mr. Tommy's son, and I don't know why he doesn't let Mr. Tommy sing with him, but I just like Mr. Tommy.
Make him look bad.
You know, I appreciate it. And I love hearing unfamiliar hymns, you know, and just because they're unfamiliar don't mean they're not popular and deep with rich doctrine. It's just things that maybe we've not heard. And then anytime we can sing a psalm or a prayer in the Bible, I'm always encouraged by that. You know, when you take God's word itself and do that, I always think it's a wonderful thing. Wonderful thing. So here we are. We're still in November, but we're past Thanksgiving, which means many of you are 100 miles an hour going for Christmas. How many of you? Tree is up, lights are up, life is good, and you're in your happy place. Maybe not right here in church, but in your life right now, you're in a happy place. Okay, good. How many of you are holding on for dear life, just trying to wait as long as you can, but the inevitable is coming? All right. Those for whom our soul prays. All right, good. All right, that's good. Well, good. Well, again, ladies, I hope if you can, you'll come tonight. Again, that dinner that we're doing is just a way for us to honor you and love on you. And the guys are going to do the three C's. They're going to cook, clean, and child care. We're going to take care of all that. And how many ever kids you bring, we promise to get most of them back to you. And we'll have a good time there. So, and guys, if you want to help out, see Wes Warnock if you'd like to help out with that, or Brother Johnny or Justin or somebody. Just a good time of us fellowshipping together as we cook and clean and do those things. And ladies, we want y'all to have a good time there as well with that. But we're going to be in Exodus chapter 20 here in just a moment. But let's go to the Lord and word of prayer. Father, come to you today. And we say, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. Lord, we thank you that we have the privilege to call you our God. And Lord, we thank you that we can also call you our Savior because of your love for us. And Lord, as we have been worshiping you, as we focus now on worship and hopefully learning, Lord, through your word, that your word would speak to us, give us what we need today. And I pray you wouldn't give us what we deserve. You might, in your grace, show mercy. Lord, help us open our eyes that we might behold wondrous things out of thy law. Be with those working with the children in the nursery and in April's class and children's church, Lord. Be with them and give them an inlet, I pray, Lord, through your Holy Spirit with those children. And God, I pray for us today as we sit here in this room and as we gather together and we worship. God, I pray you give us open minds that your Holy Spirit may work in us and on us. Lord, I pray for myself that you might forgive me of my sin, empty me of myself, fill me with your Spirit. Lord, as we look at this topic today, God, I pray that you would be glorified. May we make much of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. As you guys know, I really love preaching series. I love going through a book of the Bible. I love going through a particular Bible character, something like that. And I think one of the good things about that is that it keeps me constantly in our relationship as brothers and sisters of Christ in this church. It keeps me thinking, it keeps me praying, it keeps me considering what would be the most helpful for us, what God has us to look at and to help us. And that involves, I know, looking at God's Word. So when I'm preaching through series, one of them is normally a book of the Bible, or maybe it might be a Bible character, or maybe a topic or something like that. And I always think, like, what is the topic that we should look at? And what do we need, what do I need to help me grow in my life spiritually? Where do I need greater understanding? And how can it best serve us here as the body of Christ here? And, you know, some of those series are shorter. You know, like, for instance, our Joseph series we just finished. And you're like, Phil, that's a shorter series. Well, you weren't here for Romans then. We were almost a year in Romans. But I enjoy going through these series. I enjoy taking a Bible character like Joseph and looking at his life. And even before then, as we've done this year, as we're coming to a close of 2022, which sounds really crazy to say, as we looked at City on a Hill, and we looked at the whole idea of Christ's Sermon on the Mount, and then the miracles of Christ there in Matthew chapter number 8 and 9, as we looked at Christ's power over the different things. And around this time last year, we were in the warm and fuzzy book of Ecclesiastes, if you remember that. Remember, life is meaningless, welcome to church. We thought we'd have t-shirts with it to say that. And we looked at these things, and on Wednesday nights, we've been going through the life of David, and then we just got through going through practicing godliness and what it means to have contentment in our life and to have joy in our life and those different things. And I love that. And that's the good. And even coming up here, we'll probably over the next few Sunday mornings do some things with Advent and about the coming of Christ and what that means for us and how we should celebrate. In fact, Lord willing, if everything goes the way that I feel like God's leading us, we'll start January going through the book of Jonah and the life of Jonah, the life of the sovereign grace of God in our lives, looking at the book of Jonah in that. And so that's the good. Now the bad, although I don't know if I'm willing to call it bad, is that there are times in preaching and studying that I kind of feel compelled to step away from series and just kind of share with you what God is really hitting my heart about. And I always feel like that in preaching, is that you don't just preach what you feel like people need to hear. You preach what God's hitting you about, what God's really hammering in your life. And so last week we looked at that a little bit as kind of a standalone sermon, and today is also another one of those to where what God is really just hitting me with, and it's not necessarily in step with the series. So in the standalone sermon today, I want to, as we go into this Christmas season, as we come to the end of the year, we're going to start today by talking about idolatry. And because I think there's nothing that says happy holidays than a good sermon about idolatry, right? So... And I want us to look, as Brent read here, in Exodus chapter 20. And in Exodus 20, even if you don't have a background in church, I think as that passage was being read, if we continued some of it, it's a text that you know, and you may not know it necessarily word for word, but as it was being read, you kind of think, oh yeah, I know this text. This is what? The Ten Commandments, right? Because if you go on, after it gets through verse 6, verse 7 says, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, and verse 8, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. And then it goes on talking about honor thy father and thy mother. In verse 12, then thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, bear false witness, covet. All those things that you see, you kind of familiarize yourself. Oh, okay, we're looking at the Ten Commandments. And if you're in here, most of you, if you're over the age of 35, more than likely these things hung up on a wall in a classroom or maybe in your home, and you know that they are the Ten Commandments. One of the things that Martin Luther, who was kind of one of the fathers, if you would, of the Protestant Reformation, said about these first two commandments, that says what? Thou shalt have no other gods before me, and thou shalt not make unto thee any graven images. He said something about this. He said that when you take the first two commandments that deal with idolatry, The rest of the commands can only be broken if you break one of the first two. Martin Luther said, it doesn't matter what the rest of them are about the Sabbath day or about thou shalt not kill or not covet or adultery or stealing. He said, you can't break one of the other commandments, one of the other eight, if you would, unless you break one of these as well. He says, Luther's argument is that if you could steal, if you could dishonor your parents, if you lied to your neighbor, if you were immoral in your relationships, you'd already broken one of the two. And you'd already believed that there's something greater and more valuable in that moment than God. In that moment, you're already guilty of idolatry. And Luther is going to argue in the commentary I read, but also I believe more importantly, the Bible is going to argue that the root issue in me and the root issue in you that has to be solved in our lives when we break these commandments and do things that are outside of the glory of God is the root issue of idolatry. The root issue of idolatry. And that's why I want to talk about idolatry. Now, just a disclaimer before we dive into this, as we look at today's source and surface idols as our title there, I want you to understand that some of this information today is not original with me. It's other good, godly men that I've read, that I've studied, because I don't want you going out here today going, man, Phil is so insightful and he's so inspired. I tell you, I love to borrow brain because there's a lot more brilliant people in this world than I will ever be. So I'm just going to lay that before you. This is not from scratch, by the way. The Bible says, what, there's nothing new under the sun. And so as we go to dive into idolatry, let me define it, if we can, in our simplest form. Idolatry is valuing something more in the moment than you value God. Mm-hmm. Is valuing something in that moment more than you value God. That's base level, because we're Americans here in 2022. We don't even really have a category in our minds for idols, right? Because when we think of idolatry, we think of some group of people worshiping some monkey out in the jungle or something like that, right? Some totem pole, something out there, some wooden carving or something like that. We think about some far off land. That's what we think about. And so when you think about idols, I know this, and I thought about it, it kind of made me stir up the whole Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom thing, right? You know, made me think about the big boulder. He goes in there. He sees the golden monkey. He changes it. I love that. And that's what we think of, right? We think about some golden monkey. But to be truthful, a lot of times the idols that we worship in our lives are far sillier than some golden monkey in some temple in a faraway land. That's right. And we're going to talk about idols in two different ways. First, let me say why we're doing this. We're all guilty of it. We're all guilty of it. See, we look at these and we read these. I don't have an idol. I don't have any graven. I don't have anything like that. But I think we need to understand something is this. We all do this. And this is something I've been trying to get away from for about a month, to be honest with you. Even as we're going through the life of Joseph, God has kind of convicted me about source and surface idols that I have in my heart, in my life, and to share these with you. And we're all guilty of it. Paul Tripp said this. He says, all of our hearts are idol factories. All of our hearts are idol-producing or idol-making factories, which means our hearts are constantly creating new idols, new things that we desire to worship. The second reason is when we value something more highly than we value God, we are forced in that moment to do two things. One is to suppress the truth of God. To suppress the truth of God. And the other is then to question the character of God. Whenever we value something more highly than we do God, we suppress the truth of God, but we also start to question the character of God. When you value something there, regardless of what it is, we do those things. So let's take whatever it is. One of the crazy things about idols is this, and more often than not is this. The things that are idols a lot of times in my life and probably in your life, the crazy thing is this, they're good things. We made them ultimate things. They're good things, but we made them the goal. We made them the benchmark, the things that we are chasing in our life. They're not bad things. They're good gifts. Instead of taking them for what they are, we elevate them a lot of times more than what they should be. And when we begin to worship a good thing as an ultimate thing, what ends up happening is we suppress the truth of God and we question his character. So when we talk about idols, we're going to be talking about them in two ways, okay? We're going to be talking about them as surface idols, and then we're going to dive into what we call source idols. So first is this, surface idols. Surface idols, okay? Surface idols are what you tend to be able to see in somebody's life, right? So let's just say that you and I get together and we go sit for a cup of coffee, or we just get together to chat for a little bit, and we're sitting there for coffee, and I look at you and I ask you this question. If I say, hey, what is maybe a current struggle in your life? Where are you misfiring at in life? What's a pain point in your life? What I'm doing in that moment is asking you an open-ended question, wanting to find out where your surface items are. And you might give an example like, well, I tell you, life's really bad because of this relationship right here. Or if I had this right here, you know, things would be so much better. Or this, that, other. And so we show a lot of times our surface idols. And let me just give you some examples of these, okay? As we kind of go through here, I don't have these on the screen for you, but I'll just run through these quickly. These are some of the surface idols, some of the things that's easy to be seen and heard that, you know what, are just too highly valued in our life. First is this, image idolatry. Image idolatry. Life only has meaning, and I only have worth if I have a particular kind of look or body imagery. Now, let me chat about that for a second. That's a good thing, to be healthy, to take care of yourself. It is not a bad thing. It's not a sinful thing. Some of you with teenage boys wish they would care a little bit more about their image when they leave the house. I get that. I understand. I'm not saying it's a bad thing, okay? Scripture says a lot about being a good steward of our body. There's nothing sinful about wanting to be lovely, but it makes a pretty crummy God. It makes a pretty crummy God. The issue is the first sentence that I said. Image idolatry is life only has meaning, and I only have worth if I have a certain kind of look or body imagery. Another one is this, work idolatry. Life only has meaning, and I only have worth if I'm highly productive, getting a lot done. Now again, the Bible has a ton of positive things to say about hard work and productivity. We don't want to be lazy. I get that. The Bible is not anti these things. It's just saying you make it an ultimate thing. That's the only way you have identity in your life, if you are successful, if you are hardworking, if you are that. If you make your identity built upon being able to get things done, what do you become a slave to? Getting things done. And you're worshiping at the wrong altar. Another one's this, achievement idolatry. Achievement idolatry. Life only has meaning, and I only have worth if I am recognized for my accomplishments. Life only has meaning, and I only have worth if I'm recognized for my accomplishments or if I'm excelling in my career. There's material idolatry, and I'm running through these fast here because some of y'all don't look like you're happy with me at the moment. All right? Material idolatry. Life only has meaning, and I only have worth about a certain level of wealth, financial freedom, or nice possessions. That's where you get your identity. Now again, are any of these things bad? No, every good gift, every perfect gift cometh down from above. But when we make a good thing from God, the ultimate thing above God or equal with God, we've made it a bad thing. We've made it a bad thing. There's another one, this, and I think this is one that hits close to home that we don't recognize. Religion idolatry. Say, what do you mean by that? Life only has meaning, and I only have worth if I'm adhering to the religious moral code that I'm supposed to do in my life. So I made it to church, and I prayed before the meal. I don't cuss too much. I don't ever get drunk. So therefore, I got to be an okay Christian. It's checking the boxes. And that can become an idol, right? All right? I mean, how many times, and we've probably all been guilty of it, of feeling guilty about our lives, but hey, I read my Bible today. Hey, I did pray today. Hey, I did, you know, at least read a Bible story to the kids this year. You know, I've done something like that. We start checking off all these things that we have done, and if we're not careful, we get religious about being religious. You with me? Christianity is not about a religion, it's about a relationship, an ongoing relationship with Christ. May we never be religious about being religious. That's not where Christ is. That's where religion's found, but it's not where Christ is found. We'll keep going. Individual person idolatry. This one's fun. Life only has meaning, and I only have worth if this one person in my life is happy with me. I only have meaning and worth if this one person is happy with me. And then if you want to branch it out, inner circle idolatry. Life only has meaning and only have worth if this particular social group or professional group or some other group lets me in with that. Just a few more and the pain will be over, okay? Here we go. Family idolatry. I think this is big in the Christian, American Christianity today. Family idolatry. Life only has meaning and I only have worth if my children or my parents are happy with me. Now that's not a bad thing. Remember, it's not bad, but if it's the only way in life you feel meaning, if the only way in life you have joy is to know that everybody is getting along and approves of you, that's an idol. That's an idol, right? These are not bad things, but what do? We elevate them, right? We take a good thing and make it an ultimate thing. In this relationship idolatry, life only has meaning and only have worth if Mr. or Mrs. Wright is in love with me still. Is in love with me still. And then the last one that I have before we move on. Suffering idolatry. I think this one hits home a lot. Suffering idolatry. Life only has meaning and I only have worth if I am hurting in a problem, because only then do I feel worthy of love or am able to deal with my guilt. Only then I am able to deal with my guilt or feel worthy of love if I am suffering. Y'all want to go ahead and pray? Do the altar call now and we'll be done. Anybody mad yet? Okay. All right. I tell you, all of these hit close to home with me. Because all of these are good things, right? All of these are good things. All of these are things that we should desire, that we should want, that even to a degree God wants for us and plans to have for us in our life. But if we're not careful, the good things become an ultimate thing. It becomes the drive of your life. It determines your joy and your peace in your life instead of allowing God to determine that. Remember, a God-given joy is totally different than a circumstantial joy. And many of us live in circumstantial joy. Circumstantial joy means there's idolatry in there at some point. There's some place, and that's surface idolatry. And now here's why idolatry is so sneaky and so subtle. Nobody in this room is thinking, nobody here at all is thinking, you know, Phil, my life only has value and only has meaning if Phil and Blake. Nobody's thinking that. That's why it's so sneaky. That's why it's so subtle. No one is thinking that. No one in this room is saying, I only have value, I only have worth if I have this kind of body image, right? Nobody's saying that at all. But instead, the way we live, it reveals in such a way what's actually going on in our hearts. You know, whatever it is in your life, whatever that is, you're not thinking it out loud. You're not thinking it even to yourself, but it reveals what's going on deep in our hearts. No one's thinking that. I mean, no one's thinking my life only has meaning and I only have worth if I have the iPhone 14. I mean, nobody thinks that, right? And if I wear these kind of clothes and if this person loves me, no one thinks that. But instead, we go into debt massively for trinkets and toys and stuff that doesn't matter. But it does reveal our hearts. It does. It reveals our hearts. And so we're not thinking that first sentence. No one's thinking life only has meaning, but yet we live this way. We live this way. And all the ones that I've listed, and I know we could go on, all of these are what we call surface idols. Surface idols. They're what we see, but let's be honest, they're not the real problem. They're what we see, but they're not the real problem. Here, let me give you an example. Here kind of in our part of the country that we have in the springtime of the year, you know, when you're trying to get your yard on point, you know, I mean, you're out there the first time. You guys, I know a lot of y'all love cutting grass, love doing that stuff, making things look good. You're trying to get everything on point, and there's always this great problem that we have in this section of the country. You know what it is? We have this little plant from the depths of the great abyss called crabgrass, or mahead grass, or different types of grass, like crabgrass. Crabgrass looks like grass, but it is not grass, is it? No, it's an unstoppable, dark, wicked thing that is very hard to destroy, right? I mean, you think about it. You go out on Saturday or whatever day it is, you go out, you get your mower out, you cut the grass, you edge, you weed eat, you blow off, you get everything done, right? You sit on the porch or you sit looking through the window at your yard, you get yourself a drink because you have subdued the part of the earth that God has given you and commanded in Genesis 1 and 2, right? You have done what you need to do. I mean, you're looking at your yard, you're feeling like the man that you are, you're just waiting for the people to come through and stick that yard of the month sticker in your, I mean, you are just ready to go, right? I mean, you're there, some of y'all are like, okay, Phil, lay off my idol. Okay, but anyhow, you know what I mean, you're doing that. To only 48 short hours later, you go out the next morning, and you notice that a good bit of your yard, a good bit of your grass is not grass. It's crabgrass, right? And by the way, I found this out. Crabgrass grows at 4 times the rate of normal grass. four times the rate. So you can mow over it, but it pops right back up. And I want you to think about it like this. The way to think about these idols I just listed are these idols are like crabgrass. They're like surface idols, okay? To deal with them is simply mow over them. If that's what you do to them, if you just simply mow over them, you really don't solve anything. You really don't solve anything, right? Don't solve anything. You have to get to the heart of the issue. You have to go deeper. And that's going to take us to our second point, which is source idols or the root idols. All those things that we just talked about, all those different ones that we went through there and many more, all those stem from a deep root source. And here's what we're going to look at, source idols. And what I'm going to show you is here, and borrowing from different people that I've studied, we're going to walk through, there's four main source idols that I think we all struggle with, okay? And we're going to see in these source idols, each one of these source idols has what we call a problem emotion, And we're going to see where we can find ourselves, right? Some of us are going to listen to these four, and you're going to say, man, I find myself in that one right there. Some of us are going to find ourselves in two of them. Some of you are going to be like, well, there's three, and Lord help us. Some of you are going to be like, yep, Phil, all four. Thanks a lot. You know, thanks for encouraging me today. But let's dive in, all right? So the source idols. And maybe you want to jot these down. Maybe it'll help to you. First one is this. Comfort idolatry. The idol of comfort. Life only has meaning, and I only have worth if I have this kind of experience, pleasure, or particular quality of life. If I have a particular pleasure, experience, quality of life. The person with a comfort idol seeks comfort. They want privacy. They want lack of stress. They want freedom. What they're willing to pay for that is productivity. Productivity. They don't care about productivity. Just give me comfort. And let me say, as we continue to walk through these, a lot of these beat me with like the biggest sledgehammer spiritually you can see, okay? So I'm not throwing darts at you. I'm saying this is us, okay? So to really dig into it. See, with the comfort idol, they're more willing to not be productive at all as long as they can be comfortable. You know what the greatest nightmare is to someone that worships comfort? Stress and demands. Stress and demands. Now, I don't want you to think that some of y'all like stress and demands, Phil. I love stress. I love demands. I love chaos. Well, let me tell you, bro, we're going to get to you, okay? We're going to get to your idol here in just a minute, okay? Just give us some time. But for the comfort worshiper, if you would, the one that worships comfort, stress and demands is their biggest nightmare. Often, here's what happens to other people around us when we struggle and worship comfort. Others often feel hurt by those who worship comfort. You know why? Because laziness has collateral damage. People that are lazy in life, it brings collateral damage. And I told you that each one of these has a problem emotion. Here's the problem emotion for those who worship comfort. It's boredom. It's boredom. There are people who are constantly bored. Boredom haunts them because they've not been designed by God to sit around and do nothing. To worship comfort is to enslave yourself to boredom, okay? Worshippers of comfort see other people, even those closest to them, as potential obstacles to what? Their personal comfort. Not surprisingly then, to those who worship comfort, authentic relationships do not come easily. Deep relationships do not come easily, right? And as a result, the person is really only invested if the relationship brings what? An adequate layer of insulation, if you want to say it like that. Think about it. If you worship comfort, a good way to wonder if you worship comfort is to ask yourself, how deep are your relationships? If they're only an inch deep and you don't want to get into relationships because they require work, you might worship comfort. Because deep, rich relationships require work. Deep relationships are not the, hey, how you doing? Oh, I'm fine, bless God. Good to see you today. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Hallelujah. We don't do that, right? They're not lip service with that, all right? They require us to get into uncomfortable spaces, right? To be exposed at times, for our weaknesses to be made visible. And the one who worships comfort can't have that, will not have that. They protect themselves from that. It's too much work. So they just bounce around from relationship to relationship to best friend to best friend to boom to boom. Why? Because they never are willing to go deep in a relationship with anyone. See, the funny thing about the promise of the comfort God is this. It never delivers what it promises. It will never deliver what it promises. For all the comfort you pursue and seek, you simply make yourself more uncomfortable because the heart was created. God created us to abide in community and fellowship and work. And though comfort is not a bad thing, remember, comfort is not a bad thing, but comfort makes a terrible God. All right? Let's go to the next one. Approval idolatry. Approval idolatry. Life only has meaning, and I only have worth if I am loved and respected by, you fill in the blank. That's a fun one, ain't it? Life only has meaning, and I only have worth if I am loved and respected by. What you seek if you worship approval is approval. Okay? You want affirmation. You want love. You want relationships, and the price you're willing to pay for that is independence. You don't want to be independent. You need somebody in your life. You don't want space at all. And what is the greatest nightmare for somebody who has the idol of approval? Rejection. It's rejection, right? Now, others often feel smothered by you. You're asking them to be what they humanly cannot be in that. And here's what the problem emotion is, okay? And I'll be honest, I struggle. This is one of Phil's struggle areas. You know, confession, good for the soul, mighty heart, and the reputation, okay? I get that. But you know what the problem emotion is with an approval idolatry? It's cowardice and lying. It's cowardice and lying. What you're going to feel and have to work with all the time is the fact that you lack a spine. And what that means is, whichever group you're with, you're like this. Yeah, I know him. I hate him. He's horrible. He's a worthless person. Why would he ever do that? But then over here with this group, you're like, I love him. He is one of my favorite people in all the world. He's great. And then the problem is you got to go to bed at night. And you have to lie in bed at night and realize that you have no spine, that you're a coward, that you lie, and that you will never fully ever speak your mind and never really will have an opinion that matters, because having an opinion might cost you too much. It might cost you that relationship. It might cost you that approval in your life. It might cost something. Again, I want to keep highlighting this. It's not a bad thing to want to be approved. It's not a bad thing to be like some of y'all back here going, I hate people. I don't want anybody to like me. So this is the greatest sermon in the world. This is not what I'm saying, okay? All right? It's not a bad thing. We are designed with the desire to be approved of, okay? Because even if you are that person like, I don't care who likes me, and I'm going to yell it out, I don't care who likes me, can I go ahead and tell you something? Just because you think it's really cool to proclaim, I don't care who likes me, you're crying out for people to like you. I don't care who likes me. That's the irony of it, right? Because what are you saying? I don't care who likes me, right? Please, like me? Like my boldness for not wanting anyone to like me? I mean, that's how it works, right? That's what it does. It's the desire to be loved and affirmed. It is healthy and it is natural, right? The problem for the person with the approval idol is this. Is that they are not ultimately satisfied with God's love for them and God's acceptance of them. And that's tough. It's tough to be honest about that. Right? And realizing the idea that God's love and God's approval is most important, and people with a worship of approval will do just about anything to make people like them. Make people like them and happy with them. Approval worshipers will often overcommit, overpromise, overstate in order to gain the affirmation of others. They're normally radically insecure about their identity in Christ. They fear rejection of people and above even a biblical fear of God or a hatred of sin. They worry about what others people think most, and this leads to worry about what other people think. And often those closest to someone with an approval idol feel smothered by their neediness. And I feel like that's true, because we desire to be loved cannot realistically, a lot of times, other people can't meet that need. Okay? That was the first two. Everybody good? Everybody still with me? Anybody ready to go home? I can pray and you can slip out if you want to. These are hard, man. I'm telling you. I'm just giving you what we got here. You can do the next two. Better. Here we go. All right. Number three. control idolatry. Control idolatry. Life only has meaning, and I only have worth if I'm able to get mastery over my life in the area of fill in the blank. What a control worshiper seeks is control, right? They want self-discipline, they want certainty, they want standards, and the price they're willing to pay is loneliness and spontaneity. They're willing to sacrifice and be lonely and not be spontaneous in anything. Because you cannot be spontaneous if you worship control, right? What's the weather going to be like? Are we prepared for that? I read an article one time that a kid got on one of these and it killed not only the kid but everybody around him. So my kid's never going to get on that ever again. All right? I mean, this is helicopter parenting. And there'll never be any kind of danger in your life, right? And I'm not talking about being absurd. I'm talking about being just freaking out and pretending that you can be in control. When the reality is, we know we really can't. And the greatest nightmare for someone that worships control is this: uncertainty. Uncertainty. Others often feel condemned because here's one of the sentences that comes out of a control worshiper's mouth. Someone that worships control will say this: why can't you just fill in the blank? That's telling you that you worship control. Control means a little too much for you. And the problem emotion for those who worship control is this: worry and anxiety. The problem emotion, if you worship control, is worry and anxiety. In fact, let me try to use control in a particular way to expose idolatry. Here's what happens when we worship control. I kind of wrote this down. We seek to control our environment, and we discover we can't. So we worry, which forces us to try to control it even more, right? Which only helps us see that we aren't in any control at all, which leads to greater worry, which makes us try to control even more, which lets us down, which leads us to worry, and then we realize this: we really can't control anything, and we get stuck in this cycle of where anxiety and worry and fear just devour us in life, and we clamp down even tighter, only making what? More anxiety and more worry. Can't say amen, God say, oh me. You know, it's kind of one of those things. We get it, right? And this is the God that control worshipers serve. It enslaves them. The person with a control idol is driven to control every aspect, not just in their life, but every aspect in the lives of people around them that touch them and affect them. Okay? Because those who worship control are often so obsessed with making things go exactly as they planned that they'll pay for it through deep-seated worry and anxiety. They'll pay for it. And the mantra, a lot of times, of a control worshiper is this. You're like, I don't struggle with control. The mantra is this: if I want to get it done, and I want to get it done right, I'm going to do it myself. Nobody else can do it. Can't delegate. And we see this in how we handle money. We see this in how we handle the people around them. We see this how we micromanage every area of life. There is no peace, there's no rest, because there's always something out there coming. There's always something out there to be afraid of. I will tell you in one sense where this is a problem for me. We'll get through here in a few minutes. I know our definition of a few minutes is different, I get that. But you'll get through here in a few minutes, okay? For many of you, you'll walk out of here. I don't know what your opinion of this sermon will be, but you'll walk out of here and you're probably joyfully leaving because of what you heard, or joyfully leaving because you're out of here. Whatever it may be, do you want to know the anxiety and worry that'll hit my heart when I walk out these doors? Next Sunday's coming. I'm not lying to you. Next Sunday's coming. Wednesday night's coming. What are we going to preach on next Sunday? You're not in a series right now, Phil. There is no more Joseph. There's not, you know, Genesis 51. What are you going to preach on? Okay, what are you going to look at next week? Well, no, Christmas is coming up. Don't forget, it's Christmas time. People want to hear everything in the world about Christmas out of the Bible. And don't worry, make that Christmas sermon something they've never heard before, which is impossible to do, you know, to do that. Right? Yeah. I'm just saying hi, right? I'm just trying to be practical with you. Some of you are like, I don't care. I just get up there and say whatever God gives me. Well, we probably need to go back to the comfort idol there a little bit. But But you know what I mean? It's not that pressure is a bad thing, right? It's not that wanting things to go well is a bad thing. But when we worship it, and it's the only way that I'm going to look at the end and go, that went well. Now I'm only going to go just long enough to worry about what's coming next. Right? It's kind of like the sports fan that wins a great game and they can't celebrate anything because the next game's coming up. You know what I mean? The next thing's coming. You never can enjoy the moment because of what's going to happen next. Right? So again, I'll say this and I'll get off of me, so I preach somebody else. But it is this. So you can get up and preach, and forgive the phrase in this, I don't know a better way of saying it. The desire to preach a home run. But you know what the problem is with preaching a home run sermon? What you going to follow up with next week? So you know what you got to come to the peace of, and I've come to the peace of? God, you're in control. I'm just going to say what you want me to say. Let it fall where it falls. Let it do what it needs to do in my life. May it do what it does needs to do in the life of someone else. I don't have to be in control. But don't you get worried if somebody's not here? Man, you really think they ought to be here? Am I in control of that? Some of you are going to really worry this Christmas season because you're going to want this person to be here to hear the gospel, and that's all a great thing. Or you're going to want this person to grow close to Christ, and all that's going to be good. But let me ask you a question. What can you control? You can't control it. You can pray, we can leave it with God, and we can do those things. We come to the fourth source idol. Power idolatry. You knew that one's coming, right? Power idolatry. Life only has meaning, and I only have worth if I have power and influence over others. Life only has meaning, and I only have worth if I have power and influence over others. What you seek when you worship power is just more power. More power. We would define that as success, winning, or influence. And the price you're willing to pay to get that is to be burdened or to bear the responsibility. Okay, that is power. I'll bear it. I'll do it. I'll handle it. I got it, right? Right? I'll take care of it. If it can make more of me, if it can build me up, if it can give me more influence, more power, I'll do it. And you're willing to pay the price of being burdened and bearing the burden. And here is the nightmare for someone who worships power. It's humiliation and failure. Humiliation and failure. It's not just about winning. It's about not losing. It's not just about winning. It's about not losing. And others around those who worship power, if we're honest, when power gets too high on the list, others more than often feel used, not loved. They feel used, they don't feel loved. Why? Because the person who worships power doesn't love you like the way you think that they love you. They use you to increase their influence, to increase their power. The relationship with you is built on what you bring to them to exalt and elevate the power and influence, right? So here's the problem emotion for those who worship power. It's always anger. Always. Always anger. I have never met a violent man who doesn't at his heart level worship power, or a woman. Never met them. It's always anger in that. Now, someone with a power idol gains their identity in competition, right? And the fiercer the competition, the better. Again, there's nothing wrong with competition. In fact, around here, I find that we are fairly competitive people. You're looking at a guy that's pretty competitive, right? In a lot of ways, right? Myself and Greg, we coach girls basketball, JV basketball, at a Christian school in the middle of Tennessee. That does not sound impressive. I get that. And, you know, we went out every game, not just to beat the team, but to let them remember us as we're leaving the gym, you know. And the teams were on, we won like 99 games in a row. I mean, we loved it. So why didn't you win 100? Again, I'm not in control of those kind of things, right? I mean, we were, it's all about what? 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th grade girls, Christian school, basketball. That was the mantra. That was it, right? And there's nothing wrong. We put everything into it. We have a great relationship with those kids that played. We did that. But sometimes I look back now, me and Greg talked about it. We're kind of like, did we really lose our mind sometimes on that? Did we really have to like go home and apologize to people because we lost our mind at a basketball game? That nobody remembers the score. Well, I remember some of them. But you know, don't remember the score. Sorry, it's a memory thing. I mean, we're competitive around here. We got a pretty competitive group of men and women and teenagers around here. Have you been to a soccer game? And not just on the big field, on that little field. I mean, the World Cup is going on right now, and some of us think it probably happened on the 3 and 4 year old group right over here not long ago. I mean, there were gift cards to be won. You know, and it's fun watching parents run up and down the field, do those different things, right? We got one age group that I think we had 3 of the 4 coaches were people out of our church, and you know, as long as I beat his team, it doesn't matter. If we lose every game, as long as we beat his team. And if his team doesn't win, that's good, you know, and I'm just like, I love it. I think it's great. You know, there's no participation trophy. I mean, I love it. You know, great. You know what the participation trophy was last year if you won when I was a kid? When I was a kid, if you lost the championship, you got to watch the other team get a trophy. You didn't even get anything like that. I mean, this is like, thanks. Of course, I wasn't the second place team. We were always a championship team because we were competitive. But anyhow, you know, that's the way it was. We used to even do some, and we do it every now and then still. We'll do a day that we'll do adult, like kids versus teens, and that's normally fun. And every now and then, we'll throw in a flag football game. I mean, there's printed out rules that we do, right? Full-on tournament. I mean, there's no physical altercations, even though I think a few times we've crept close to that line a little bit of time. So you know what we do at church events now? We play cornhole. That's what we do. You just sit there and throw the bag. Have a good day. You know, it's not quite as inflaming as flag football or something else, but we love competition here, right? I would never, ever for a moment downplay competition. It's a good thing. It's a gift from God. Competition winning. It's great stuff. It's just a terrible God. It just is. It just is. And another way to describe the power worshiper is to say their primary motivation in life is not so much to win, but just as long as I avoid losing and looking bad. To those who struggle with power, not only do they tend to be violent people, but studies have shown will oftentimes struggle with things like gambling and addiction to games where they can win. I mean, their heart is most often exposed when they lose or feel humiliated. You know, someone who worships power, you know, they will ride go-karts and they will spin out their mama on a go-kart track to make sure they win the thing. You know what I mean? And some of you are like, you know what I mean? And that's what you do, right? Because you like and we worship power. And all of us, I think, regardless of what you're thinking, your felt need is looking at this. And looking at these different things. I think all of us, if I could say, hey, what's going on in your life? What's going on in your life? What are you hoping that God could grow you in? What area of your life? Where do you feel weak? And if you're like, well, maybe my body image is a real issue for me, then I'm struggling with. Maybe materialism is a real issue that I'm struggling with. Relationships are a real struggle. Maybe legalism in church is a big thing. What I'm going to say to you, if you say that, is this. Praise God that he's given you some eyes to see that surface idol. But let's go deeper, right? Where does that spring from? What's really causing it? Is it comfort? Is it approval? Is it control? Are you really after power? What is it? And it's in those spaces that I think we can consider and try to get to the bottom of what's going on really much inside of us. Okay? And why should we do this? Well, because if we're worshiping one of these source idols, then we're suppressing again the truth of God and we're calling God's character into question. We're taking a good thing and we're making it an ultimate thing. Therefore, we're becoming enslaved to something that really God made for us to glory in and worship and have joy. Everything's on the line. So maybe as we walk through some of this, and I've said this and you're like, man, that's me. Or maybe you're like, well, I'm really not quite sure. Or maybe you're like, Phil, I am all for. Thanks for ruining my Thanksgiving weekend. I don't know. Some of you maybe, I don't know what I am, but I'm really angry right now and I'm getting bored because I'm lonely. I don't know what it is you may be at right now. And maybe you're just totally completely discombobulated. Here's the good news. When it comes to idols, God would simply have us do one thing. Repent. Repent, right? And maybe there's a question of how we should do that. And we're going to throw this on the screen here. These are the two pillars, if you would, of the gospel. And I don't know how well you can see that. But there's two pillars of the gospel. When we're talking about repentance, the gospel, and for us to understand that, the first pillar is this, to understand this, is that the first pillar is that I am, thinking of me and all this, I am completely sinful. And that's true of every human being, all of mankind. I am completely sinful. Yet the other pillar of the gospel is this, I am fully accepted by God. Those are the two pillars, excuse me, of the gospel. So when we're talking about idolatry, we're talking about what? Seeing our sin. You have to see your sin. Because here's the deal. Part of what we're doing here and have to understand is this. You can't repent of something that you don't see as an issue. You can't do it. Excuse me. So part of what we're doing here today is laying down some language so for us to see, so you can hear, okay, man, I am a comfort worshiper. Okay? I'm not a God worshiper. Man, I care more about what other people think than I care about what God thinks. The reason that we're having this study today is so that you can see it by the grace of God. Then if you can see it, if you can see your sin, if you can see it, here's the second step that honestly few people want to make. The second step that few people want to make is this, that if you've seen it, own it. If you've seen it, now you got to own it, right? And this is so counterintuitive in our country and right in our culture. Here's what I mean by that. Your sin is not something external to you. You don't sometimes, and here's what I have to remember. I don't sometimes lie. I'm a liar. Okay? There's a difference in those two sentences, right? I love you. You don't sometimes lie. You're a liar, right? That's just the truth of it. That's what it is. And what we like to do is distance ourselves from what we actually are, right? We say, well, I'm not a reviler, or I'm not a liar, I'm not immoral. I just do those things sometimes. I just struggle with them though sometimes. No, the truth is, that's what we are. That's what we are. And it's really, we need to understand, is when we own it, that is the gateway to your joy in Christ. That is the gateway to having peace and joy in your life, is not just seeing it, but owning it so you can turn away from it. See, the problem is so many of us, we barely sometimes even see our sin, but then we walk out the door of a church or we close our Bible at home or we start thinking or going about our daily routine and we never own it, so therefore we never turn from it in our lives. Hey, one of the things that the Apostle Paul does through the New Testament a lot that honestly I think gets on the nerves of a lot of people until you understand it is that Paul always reminds us of what we used to be. Paul always does that. I mean, do you ever sometimes read the Apostle Paul and you're like, man, why has he got to keep bringing up what I was before Christ? I mean, you think about it, Ephesians chapter 2, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, Romans 1, and in Titus 3, he's like, you were revilers, you were drunkards, you were addicts, you were lustful. And you kind of think to yourself in reading that part of Scripture, hey, why does Paul keep bringing this up? I thought I was free. Like, Paul's not the guy you're inviting to the Christmas party because Paul's the guy that's going to step up and say, hey, glad for today, but you remember where we were last year? You remember where we came from? He's always bringing that stuff up. But the second pillar is this, I am fully accepted in Christ. If you're here and you're in Christ, that means this, I have been forgiven fully, freely, and forever. And Paul would sometimes say, Paul, let it go, who I used to be. But why won't Paul let it go? And I want you to get this. I please want you to get this. Because if we're not willing to own what we are, we will never be able to rejoice in all that God has done for us. If you will never willing to own who you are, you will never be able to fully rejoice and have joy in all that God's done for you. Jesus tells a beautiful story in Luke chapter number 7. If you remember, he's sitting in the house of Simon the Pharisee. And if you remember the story, right, he's sitting there and a prostitute comes in. She sees Jesus and she falls at his feet and she starts weeping at the feet of Jesus and she's crying and she's literally washing his feet with her tears and with her hair. And remember what Simon the Pharisee thought to himself? He thought to himself, if Jesus knew what kind of woman this was, he would not let her touch his feet. And Jesus answered his thought, which, by the way, is always freaky to me. If you read through Scripture, Simon didn't say a thing. Simon thought to himself, and Jesus responded. I always find that interesting. And remember what Jesus says to Simon, quick question. Two men owed a debt to a lender. One owed a whole bunch, and I'm paraphrasing here, and the other owed just a little. One owed a lot, one owed a little. Both were forgiven of their debt. Who do you think was more grateful? And Simon the Pharisee says, knowing that he's busted, he said, well, I suppose the one who owed more. And Jesus says, you've answered correctly. And then Jesus goes on to say, he says, when I came into your home, Simon, you did not give me a kiss, and you gave me no water to my feet, and you gave me no water to wash my feet. Now, if that didn't give me a kiss thing kind of messes you up, just think about the culture and day and age of when they were, okay? It was an affection of that. It meant to show hospitality, friendliness. But Jesus is saying, you did not honor me. You did not show me any hospitality. You did not show me that I was even really wanted or desired to be here. You gave me nothing to wash my feet. But this woman, from the second that she has walked through the door, has not stopped kissing me and washing my feet with her tears. He says, so although her sins are many, they are forgiven fully. Forgiven fully. Jesus points to that room, and Jesus' point to our room today is this, is that when we own our sin as we should, we move toward this idea here that I'm a bigger sinner than I thought. And our culture tells us this, don't worry about that. Don't think about who you were. Remember how awesome you are. Can I tell you, the doctrine of awesomeness will steal and rob the joy you have in Christ. And that's a doctrine being shoved down our throats and our kids and grandchildren's throats today. Is there's nothing wrong with you. You're awesome in your sinfulness. And the thing is, don't you understand? God did fearfully and wonderfully make us. But without God, I stand in sin. Without God, without the sacrifice of Christ, I stand without a Savior. I need to be saved. I need to be redeemed. And when we're able to own our own sins, that I am broken, I am rebellious, I do worship power, I don't worship God. I think I know better than God sometimes. I try to control things sometimes and not trust Him. When we do those things, we have to remember that all of our idols are accusations against God. All of our accusations against God are unfair and undue and unfounded against the Creator of the universe, because when I worship power, or I worship approval, or I worship those things, what I'm doing is I'm accusing Him of not blessing me the way I feel like I need to be blessed. And I forget that I'm breathing the air that He created. So to own sin creates a desire for us to dig into what the real problems are. So here's the thing. When I want to own my own sin, I'm willing to go to the deep, dark places of my heart that I wish nobody would see. I'm willing to God to know me. And by faith, after we repented, that's where the faith pillar comes in. After repentance and by faith, now we're shooting up to what? Now I am fully accepted. Now Christ is a bigger Savior than I've ever experienced in life. And you'll be able to rejoice in that. Because here's the problem. You'll never be able to rejoice if you don't think you're guilty of anything. Which is why Paul constantly keeps bringing up in the New Testament, this, and this is what we were. And when we get to the part where we start to believe that Jesus wants to see my sin, wants to forgive my sin, and wants me to repent, and wants me to trust in Him only, man, that there is where we can find true glory and true joy. It's only there when we lean into our shortcomings. We don't numb them from our minds. We spend time thinking about them. I mean, how counterintuitive is that to actually think about where you fail? I tell you, one of the great things that we see in Scripture is this. And all those things I told you about, all those places where Paul says, and you did this, and you were that, and every one of those passages of Scripture, there comes a beautiful three-letter word after that. But. But. But God, who is what? Rich in mercy, who is steadfast in love, saves us through Christ. We see that God's activity in the saving of our souls. But the problem is, we live in a world today that says, don't take any fault for what you do wrong. Maybe your daddy didn't hug you enough as a kid. Maybe your spouse, if they just did this, then everything would be great here. And if you just acknowledge maybe what some other people done, that's the mantra of the day. And can I tell you, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. And so as we close, maybe you're here and you're thinking to yourself, yeah, Phil, this is fine. Maybe I'll repent one day. I mean, I just don't really know if my heart's there with it today. Maybe you could just do this. Maybe if you don't feel in your heart that you can repent, maybe you don't feel in your heart That, yeah, you know there's some things wrong, but you're just not there yet. Maybe if you would just be willing to name your idol. Maybe do a little work, name your idol, take a step in the right direction. I'm not saying that your heart is broken, you're not full on repentant, but maybe just do a little work to say this, okay, this is my idol, and you're just willing to at least name it. Because when you're willing to at least name it, man, I worship power. I worship control. I worship approval. I worship comfort. It's when you're willing to name it that the Holy Spirit can begin to unmask it for you. That the Holy Spirit can begin to do those things. Because if you worship control, you know you can't control it, and you know that the worry and anxiety you walk in is going to betray you. Because I joke about it like this, and I say this a lot of times. You ever go on vacation and come back and you need a vacation from your vacation?
Yep.
But I need to remember something. The idols that I have in my life are grievous to Christ. They're grievous to Christ. And we need to remember that. And you only need to look at the cross to see that. You only need to use your sanctified imagination, if you would, to ponder them as, I know we're going to worship the baby in the manger, but to understand the ultimate purpose, that one day they were going to rip the flesh off his back. They're going to hit him in the face so much that you won't be able to recognize him. He's going to be tortured. That he's going to make screams as they drive the nails through his hands and feet. And brother and sister in Christ, it was for your comfort and my comfort and your approval and my power. It was all about me that he did all that. It was for me and for you. It wasn't necessarily just for them. And so I want us to consider that Christ comes and wants to bid us to be clean, to be forgiven. And the only way to displace idols in our lives, I think that we all do, that we all want to do, is to remember it's not going to come by just trying harder. It's going to come by divine intervention. It's going to come by trusting in Christ rather than trusting in comfort. And if you're here today, as I close, and you're not a Christian, can I tell you something? There's no way to displace any idol in your life without Christ. There's no way. Because even the most staunch, God-hating atheist out there worships something. We're all created to worship something.
That's
right. He or she might just worship the human intellect. But can I tell you something? That makes a really crummy God, too. You can't help but worship. You're created to do it. You were built to do it. You were designed for it. But here's the question. What are you worshiping today? May it be Christ. Let's stand together, if you would. Father, I thank you for the opportunity today to consider these things. I pray, God, through the Holy Spirit, that you would give us clarity in these moments. Whether we can just recognize the surface, or maybe, God, by your grace, we can see some source. I just pray that you would bring about clarity in our hearts and our minds, that we'd be able to name them, that we'd be able to understand more fully what's going on in us and underneath these things that we struggle with. And God, for those of us who have experienced some victory in some of these areas, we praise you today for that. But I pray all the more that you would expose those areas where we worship things that are no gods at all. Will you reveal to us what the actions of our lives and the states of our hearts are? God, would you allow the weight of that to even break our hearts? For your patience with us, God, we're overwhelmed and we thank you. You're gracious and kind and we praise you. Thank you for your love. In Christ's name. If you don't mind, with your heads bowed and eyes closed just for a moment, Brent's just going to play through something. And I won't keep you long. But maybe with your heads bowed and eyes closed, maybe God did bring something to your mind and to your heart. Maybe it's like that crabgrass. Maybe it's just something on the surface. Then I'm thankful he brought it to the surface. But you know in your heart and mind that just mowing over isn't going to work. But it's digging down to what is the root, what is the source. Again, if one of these source idols is a struggle in your life, or maybe maybe two, three, or all four, can I just tell you, we all struggle. We all struggle. But the answer to that is, if we confess our sin, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It can all change. May God help us see. But God, may He also help us all. Appreciate you being here today. Appreciate you listening. Again, this is one of these things that is, God's been beating me up about this, and I hope He continues to beat me up about it, and that's because He loves us. But if we can ever be a help, we want to be a help. We can pray. The Bible says that we bear one another's burdens, so fulfill the law of Christ. And so if we can be a help, we definitely want to do it. Well, we'll close in a word of prayer, and don't forget about the different things the ladies think tonight. Don't encourage you ladies for that. Men's fellowship tomorrow. And again, I hope you have a great day. I'm going to ask Greg, if you don't mind again, to close the purpose.